Hello and welcome to Worldview at the Hindu with me, Sahasini Heather. We're trying this week to unravel one of India's closest and most complex relationships, that between New Delhi and Colombo.
And now the government has bowed down to the pressure. It has halted the strategic East Container Terminal with India and Japan.
And now, nearly a month on, Colombo has decided to course correct. It has offered the West Container Terminal at the same port to India and Japan.
After weeks of what seemed to be a strain in ties over Sri Lanka's decision to cancel the East Container Terminal project that was with India and Japan, a truce of sorts seems to have been effected, with India saying it will go ahead with the deal for the West Container Terminal project instead, while Japan's role is still being discussed, no decision taken yet. So where do India-Sri Lanka ties stand now, with all the recent high-level visits and developments? The visit also of Pakistan's Prime Minister and the impending vote at Geneva's Human Rights Council on a resolution against Sri Lanka. Events of the last few weeks have seen what we think of as a seesaw in ties. So take a look at some of those events. On the one hand, there was a visit by External Affairs Minister S. Jaishankar. Then there was a trilateral security meeting with Maldives that the National Security Advisor, Mr. Ajit Doval, attended. The Indian Air Force Chief visited Colombo for the Sri Lankan Air Force's 70th anniversary celebrations. And also India has been sending COVID vaccines to Colombo. About 500,000 have been sent just as a gift so far. But on the other hand of that balance, what we have seen is Colombo cancelling the ECT MOU that we spoke about that had been signed 2 years ago. It is reportedly now seeking to reacquire the Trincomalee oil tank farms leased out to an Indian oil corporation subsidy. Remember, this is part of an entire group of agreements on India, between India and Sri Lanka, where India was going to develop infrastructure projects in Trincomalee on the east of Sri Lanka that have so far made very little progress. Sri Lanka also cleared its first project in the north. This is significant, just off the Jaffna Peninsula, for a Chinese renewable energy company as well. Mahinda Rajapaksa rolled out the red carpet, quite literally, arrived at the airport to welcome Pakistan's Prime Minister Imran Khan for a two-day visit in February. Pakistan, during that visit, Mr. Khan made an open offer, extended the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, CPEC as it's known, to Sri Lanka for infrastructure projects there. Mr. Khan also announced a $50 million defense line of credit for Colombo, which is a first of sorts. Clearly, all of this is being watched very closely and with some concern by India. So where are those ties headed now? Let's just take a look at all these various issues. First, on the West Coast Terminal deal that is now taking the place of the East Coast Terminal project, despite what the government say on both sides, the two projects are really not the same. They are not comparable. To begin with, the ECT has been completed about 40%, whereas the WCT, the Western Container Terminal, has to be built from scratch. The ECT is also next to a shallow terminal, which helps with quick cargo transfers to the deep terminal. The WCT is not. It is strategically located, the ECT, not as strategically located when you look at the WCT. Sri Lanka has also, of course, offered for the ECT, had offered only a minority stake of about 49% to India and Japan. But in the WCT, it is willing to offer much more, as much as 85%. That puts that stake at par with what Sri Lanka has offered China in another neighboring terminal project called the CICT, the Colombo International Container Terminal Project. So both the WCT and the CICT will see foreign investment of up to 85%. However, this will also mean that Adani Ports, that has taken the project from the Indian side, as well as Japan's investment agency, will have to put much more investment into this new project. The details of just how much are still awaited. The Rajapaksa government had said that it had to backtrack on the deal because of public pressure from the port unions as well, who said that they opposed foreign ownership in the strategically located ECT. But it is believed that other upsets have played a part. Most likely, India's refusal to commit to a debt repayment moratorium request that was made personally by Prime Minister Rajapaksa when he had come to Delhi to meet with Prime Minister Modi in February of 2020. Also delays in the $1 billion currency swap arrangement that Sri Lanka had requested. These have all increased the strain in ties. Even so, it is unlikely, given that the decision has been made to go ahead now with the WCT, not to make an issue of Sri Lanka's cancellation of the ECT, that this will be a defining issue. So let's turn to the next one on Pakistan. It must be remembered that Sri Lanka has always held independent relations with Pakistan. It had participated recently in Pakistan's naval exercise with 45 countries. We also saw the Pakistani Air Force chief just visit Sri Lanka as well. If you want to look at history, in the 1971 war, the run-up to it, Sri Lanka had even allowed Pakistani flights to refuel in Colombo before India expressed concerns, and that practice was ended. However, in the broad picture, Sri Lanka's relations and security ties with India are much too strong to be swayed by any other country. If Pakistan's offers on CPEC, however, are in conjunction, say for example, with China, which already controls many key projects in Sri Lanka, then that is definitely more important to watch. So let's turn to the third event, and that's the upcoming event, the expected Human Rights Council resolution, which is deeply critical of the Rajapakse government, of its record in resolving the alleged human rights abuse cases since the war on LTT in 2009, also in holding its own military accountable. Remember, President Gotabaya Rajapakse played a key defense role at that time. The vote is expected by March 22nd this year, and India's vote will be an important piece in the puzzle that is bilateral ties. A vote for the resolution against Sri Lanka could clearly go badly for the bilateral relationship. An abstention, particularly given that India has a principle, it does not accept country-specific resolutions at the UN body, perhaps that would be more palatable for Colombo and would keep an equitable peace. On the other hand, the Modi government would also have to consider its position vis-a-vis the upcoming assembly elections in Tamil Nadu. And while Sri Lanka does say it hopes that India will join Russia, China, Pakistan, Nepal, other countries in voting against the resolution, remember the Human Rights Council is made up of 47 members, that might not be as easy given the political considerations. In an interview to the Hindu's Meera Srinivasan, in fact, the Sri Lankan Foreign Secretary, Kolumbage, said India cannot abandon Sri Lanka. He added that if the Modi government believes in Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, or a global family, then Sri Lanka would be immediate family. But despite all those statements made, it is clear that both sides understand that India might have to take what it calls a two-pronged path. In fact, that's what it said at the Human Rights Council, where it looks both at its ties with Sri Lanka. It looks certainly at the sovereignty aspect of these resolutions, the territorial integrity of Sri Lanka. But it has to be balanced, of course, with the rights of the minority. One, it said, will lead to the other. Now, there's a lot more on our website on this issue, www.thehindu.com. You can read Meera's interview, as I said, many columns and podcasts as well. For book recommendations, here are two. There's the historic perspective from a newly brought out book called Haksar on India's Sri Lanka Policy that really looks at the beginnings of how India dealt with its Sri Lanka policy. The more recent recent book would be Choices by Shivshankar Menon, the former National Security Advisor who had dealt with Sri Lanka extensively. So please do keep your comments coming in. We do read them. We try as much as possible to respond to the questions you have, including this week. But that's all we have time for. From the team here, thanks for watching.